Welcome back, Doodlebugs. It's Mary, and it's part two of the Artcast featuring my painting From Bad to Worse. In part one, I answered some of your questions and talked about the materials I used, and I'm going to answer some more questions because we got some juicy ones, some heavier questions. If you want to see the time-lapse version of this painting, I'm going to include a link on the screen and in the description below, so you can check that out. And just a quick review of the materials I'm using. This is a watercolor painting with liquid black India ink and some salt, as I am currently adding in the video. And it's all on watercolor paper. This is a thicker paper designed to allow lots of water to be put on it and to not completely warp or tear, although it's still possible to warp and tear it if you abuse it too much. Another technique I'm using that you're seeing in the very beginning of this video is a technique called scarring, where you take an object, in this case a nail file, and you scratch at the paper to create some darker lines and effects. Again, this is a really cool technique. I do advise, you know, if you have thicker paper, go ahead and try it. If you're painting on, let's say, computer printer paper, it's probably having a hard enough time handling watercolor, so it might not work as well. But as you can see from the video, it creates darker lines, and you can almost draw in shapes. Because what happens is, when you scratch the paper, it creates a divot, like a ravine, and so water pools in. That's the other thing. This works when the page is still wet. And so the water will pool into that little scratch. And as it dries, it'll dry darker because watercolor paint goes where it's wet. And so if the water flows to a certain area of the page, it's gonna pull more color, more pigment with it, and create a darker or more vibrant color. As you can see on the whale, which is the figure that is still very much wet, that's all wet paint, there's an area on the far left by its nose, and then on the far right, kind of by its haunch, by its bump, that the water has pooled there and it's pulled in some more paint. So yeah, in part one, I created the characters, the sailor, the kraken he's battling, and the whale whose belly they rest in. And for the most part in this video, I'm gonna be working on the background and doing these layers that are a series of washes where I'll lay down very wet paint and let the paint bleed out and then let it dry and put down another layer on that. And it's what I'm going to be doing is playing with transparency, because watercolor is a transparent medium. So when you make a layer and then you put another layer on top of it, the bottom part will show through. And hopefully the goal was to create lines implying underwater currents or kind of this fantastical wavy look. This is a technique that I kind of observed another artist do when I was in middle school. I was like 13, 14 years old, back in the days of Elfwood. I was on Elfwood and DeviantArt so much more. And there's an artist named Stephanie Poumanla who does these fantasy watercolor paintings that are so gorgeous. And she would do a lot of these layers to create these transparent swirls, almost like you can see the wind blowing around and pulling at characters and at their hair and at their clothes. And it's beautiful, beautiful work. And I think just by looking at her paintings and being really into watercolor, I was inspired to try this technique and figure out how to do it myself, which I figured out was, you know, layers. And yeah, that's kind of the origin of the style. It's something that I fell away from for a bit, but I've been doing more of these sweeping layers in more recent paintings, which is fun. It's kind of like a going back to something that I was really into as a kid and revisiting that. So speaking of revisiting, this is not speaking of revisiting. This is just visiting questions, because I got a lot of great questions and comments on part one. So let's get into that. So that I'm going to try to get through all the ones that I've wanted to do. But before we do that announcement, some live events. I'm going to be present at this year. Coming up April 22nd through the 24th, I'll be at Playlist Live in Orlando, Florida. If you want to come say hi to me there, it's going to be my very first Playlist Live, and I'm kind of excited. And then June 23rd through the 25th, I will be at VidCon again in Anaheim, California. And if you're planning on coming to any of those events, I would love to see you. So hit me up on Twitter at Mary Doodles. Let me know if you're planning on going or if you're definitely going. And I want to maybe set up a meetup or like a drawing event where we sit down with our sketchbooks. I don't know. All right. Enough of that. Let's get to questions. The first question is from Michael Dixon, who says, "Hi, Mary. I don't know if you're still looking for questions, but I was wondering, how do you value your art for sale? I've recently thought about selling some of my art, but it makes me cringe to put a price on it. Any advice would be great. Thanks from the UK." Hello, UK. Hello from Los Angeles. Yeah, this is a very cringy, tricky thing to do. It's all about valuing yourself in a way, and making something and putting a price tag on it can be incredibly awkward, especially, I feel, because artists are rarely 100% satisfied with their work. And I've made paintings or drawings in the past where, for me, it's like a throwaway, or it's something that I was not at all satisfied with personally. However, somebody else, an outsider who had no idea what my intentions were for this final thing to look like, they see what I made and they see value in it. And you know, I've had people offer to buy paintings that I just felt awful selling, because to me, it's like, this is not good. This is not what I wanted to do. It's a big error, and I feel bad for you for wanting to give me money for this. That said, go for it. Always sell it if that happens, because it's just good for everybody involved. You know, and it's sort of like music. You know, you have the music that you love, and then maybe you have a friend who, for whatever reason, likes that band or that song, and you're like, or when that horrible song comes up on the radio, you're like, who listens to this? Well, someone does. Someone finds value in it. And somebody is going to find value in your work, you know, if you put your love and energy into it. It's like true love. There's someone out there for everybody. You just gotta find them. And so if you find somebody who values your work, awesome, cool. Pricing your work. I would advise what I did, which is advice I was given. Look at the materials you're using and the time it takes for you to make your paintings or your drawings or whatever it is, and then look at other artists who create similar works with similar materials and gauge what they're charging. Now, you always want to be sure that you're covering your expenses when you're selling your paintings. So let's say you buy a very large canvas and it costs you $30 US dollars, and then you can't sell it for anything under $30. And if you sell it for $35, well, you haven't really made much of a profit. And it also doesn't cover the amount of time that you spent on this, because that time could have been spent pouring coffee and making money at some establishment. So you do want to cover your material expenses and a bit of your time expenses. This is also very important to remember when you're pricing for shipping. There's a lot of online venues now, like Etsy, or you can create your own websites where you sell your work to anyone, anywhere in the world. And shipping is also an expense that you want to build into the price, or warn the buyer that they will have to pay for the shipping. There have been a few times where I've priced something and I did not estimate the cost of shipping to, say, Australia, and the painting was sent off, and actually would lose money because of the shipping expenses. So, which is so painful when you finally get somebody buying your thing and you're like, yes, awesome. I can now afford the internet bill this month. And then, oh, wait, no, I lost all of that and then some because of shipping. So do a little research, you know, and again, look at what other people are doing with similar materials and style. And it's okay to put value on your work. I think so much of it is the mental hurdle and saying, this is a thing I made and you should give me this much money for it. And you're going to hear different things from different people. I've had days where I check my emails and in one email, somebody's saying, your work is really good. You should be charging way more. And in the next email, somebody's saying, why is it so expensive? I really want one of your paintings and I can't afford it. And that's just life. You know, money is relative to the person. You know, it's like beauty is in the eye of the beholder. There's a time in my life where $10 was a lot of money. $20 was a lot of money. And, you know, now $20 is something that, yes, that is an affordable expense that I can use to buy this frivolous sweater at a thrift store that I will grow tired of in a few months because summer's coming. I hope that helped out with your question and gave you a good starting place. The next question is from Lord of Combat. It's kind of a similar thing. Where do I start career-wise with art? And I, not knowing what kind of art you want to do career-wise, maybe that's a good starting point, is sitting down and journaling or making a list of the kinds of jobs that you would want involving your art or the kind of art that you like to make, you know, and think abstract and big. You know, what is your ideal? Are you wanting to be living in a cabin on a mountain just making paintings? Or do you see yourself in an animation studio designing characters? You know, just brainstorm where it is that you want to go and then trace the steps of people who have gone those directions. And, you know, a lot of times, like with anything in the early stages of your career, you're going to be doing jobs that you're not thrilled about. You're going to be the low man on the totem pole. You might take on an internship where you're so close yet so far from the thing you actually want to do. But just keep in mind that these steps in life will add and influence and inform where you end up, and it helps to build the person that and the artist that you're going to become. This next question is more of a comment reacting to something I said in part one about senioritis. When you are in high school, let's say, and you're just taking those whatever classes to get the credits and you're ready to move on emotionally. I got a comment from Winds of Nevermore who says, what you mentioned about senioritis is exceptionally true, and I can personally vouch for that. I am currently in 11th grade at school, and I'm starting to see, as the rest of the year goes on, the less I'm interested in most of my required courses, and I see myself only trying to the extent that will get me to pass them. In past high school years, I was a good student with a high average and good grades, but my teachers have seemed to be catching on to my mood, and most classes have been catching on to my mood in most classes and have taken to thinking that something is wrong, maybe in my health or personal life. Oh no, I'm sorry to be laughing. That's a nice, funny misunderstanding. But that's not the case. I'm just starting to figure out what is more relevant in my life and what actually makes me happy and gets me to enjoy my school life. Looking ahead into grade 12, I'm at the point where I'm actually needing two classes just to fill in my schedule, not for credit, but for general school requirements. My school doesn't offer most courses that I'd actually be interested in and would be beneficial to further my growth as an artist, such as graphic design or architecture. Mary, do you have any suggestions as to what I should try or do? Yeah, that's tricky when you have like these classes that you have to take and you're just totally not interested. Piggybacking on what I previously said about ending up having to do the things that you aren't really excited about. If you can at all adjust your attitude, if you find yourself in that position where you just have to do this thing, adjusting your attitude and embracing the experience as either a challenge or an opportunity to learn something or become influenced by a totally unconnected thing will eventually down the line really inform your life. Let's say you somehow end up on a fishing boat and you have to be on this fishing boat for 6 months and you don't want to be a fisherman, you want to be an artist. Well, odds are your experience on that fishing boat will somehow influence your art and give you a very new, unique point of view. Taking a whatever class for the sake of whatever is not nearly as exciting as being on a fishing boat. But if there's nothing at all related to art, try to find something that is somehow related to a topic that you are personally interested in, and maybe make it a challenge to find that thread from that topic to your art. And another thing is, you know, it seems like your teachers, you mentioned, are a little concerned, and that's cool. That means they're paying attention, which is great. And maybe now is a good time to open some lines of communication to those teachers. Because, you know, I feel like I have a friend who's a teacher now, and it's so weird. It's like, oh, I could be a teacher. Now I'm driving the bus. That's scary. But he does teach high school students. And he is actually very excited to talk to kids who are interested in either their own education or just other topics. You know, teachers have to deal with weirdos all day. And think of the most annoying dum-dum in your class. Teachers have to deal with those people in bulk all the time. And they love intelligent students who are just interested in taking the wheel and driving their own life because they don't want to take care of you. And yet they find themselves having to take care of kids who can't drive their own life. So maybe, you know, talk to them and say, hey, you know, I'm not super excited about this topic, but if there's anything I can do involving my art, you know, if let's say there's a final project or research paper that you have to write, maybe go to them and say, I would love to somehow incorporate my art into this research project. Maybe I'll create a graphic novel about this topic or something like that. And, you know, just let them know this is what I'm wanting to work on. I'm wanting to focus more on furthering myself and growing as an artist. How can I use my skill and combine that to the results that you need me to show as a teacher? And work that out. And more often than not, you'll find that teachers are really great at, you know, they love that. It's refreshing. And if they're unmoving, well, then just treat that as a lesson in dealing with people in the real world, because you know what? That's always going to be a thing. That's always going to be something you come up against. I hope that helped out. Let's go to the next comment from Artistic Panda. Who says, please help. Mary, I'm in eighth grade, and when I get older, I want to be an English teacher, and I also want to go to art school. Which do you think I should do first, or should I not go to art school at all? I love your art and your videos. Oh, thank you, Artistic Panda. I would say you're in eighth grade right now, so the good news is you don't have to make a decision anytime soon. It may seem very soon in the grand scheme of things, though. You've got plenty of time, and I don't mean to scare or alarm anybody, but there's a chance that you could change the way you feel about things. There's plenty of time for it to change. And I, you know, when I was in eighth grade, I felt my feelings at that time were just that's how it was going to be. It felt so eternal and so present, and I could not imagine wanting to do other things, and that my desire would change as I grew up. I did definitely think that I was going to do some kind of career with art and drawing and painting, because that's what I was good at, and that's all I did in the classroom, and people told me I was good at it. But then, like, around your age, I actually started doing more theater and more sketch and comedy shows in the community. And around your age, eighth grade, that's when I started thinking beyond art and wondering, well, maybe, you know, do I want to, like, do Saturday Night Live? Do I want to be in theater and doing plays? Is that what I really want? And, you know, up until, I think, I'm going to say 10th grade. Yeah, like between 7th and 10th grade, I'm going to say, I was all gung-ho about doing theater. I thought, maybe this is going to be where I'm at. Maybe I won't do art. And then I just happened to take a class involving digital video and filmmaking. And that just flipped everything around. And that happened in one semester. And suddenly I went from maybe doing art, but most likely theater, to definitely film school. So, which, you know, as you learned in part one, I did drop out, but somehow that helped inform me now regarding creating YouTube videos and art. And I figured out how to mesh it all together. So, you know, perhaps there's a career that has yet to exist that will require art and English and literature in the future that you could create, or you could find that path. So yeah, I guess long story short, don't panic. You got time. And as you get closer to figuring out what the next step is in life and in your path, I think, you know, follow what you're feeling more strongly toward. And, you know, there's no wrong answer. There's just choices. And some choices are going to make things easier for you. And some choices are going to make things maybe not as easy. But if you're really passionate about something, you'll find your way and you'll carve it out. Let's do a question from from Judas Spencer, who says, I love your art style. And what is the best way to draw better? And don't say practice. Followed by a string of emojis. And my response was practice. And I'm so sorry, Judah, but that's the way it's got to be. And then I followed up with one thing I recently heard. It was a quote saying something like, if you can't measure it, you can't manage it. And this is regarding all sorts of things in life and self-betterment, whatever. We don't need to talk about that. But I will say, if you want to get better at something, it is much easier to really refine what that something is rather than making it abstract. The example is, you know, you could say, I want to learn Spanish, which is kind of a broad thing. But if you can narrow it down and say, you know, in 6 months, I want to be able to communicate in Spanish what I do for a living and where I'm from, you know, and learn some conversational bits and something like that. So, you know, if you're applying that to your art, you could say, I want to know how to draw eyeballs, or I want to learn how to draw perspective, or I want to improve my shading. I want to be able to draw light and shadow, all sorts of stuff. You know, you really can focus on one area you want to improve, and then you practice, Judah. Judah, you gotta practice. Why aren't you practicing, Judah? Ooh, that's the other thing. I think when people say you gotta practice and practice makes perfect, to me, that triggers this memory of when I was a child. Let me tell you about when I was a child. And my mom made me take violin. And I wish I knew how to play violin now. But I hated violin practice and rehearsals. And I'd have to go to practice. And I would drive to this place and I would dread it. I dreaded violin practice. And so the word practice, when you're told to practice, it probably makes you feel like, oh, this must be a chore. I think we associate the word practice with chore. And honestly, Judah, if you enjoy drawing, and you then you probably are practicing on your own, no problem. You know, if you like to draw, you're going to draw and it won't feel like practice. But you are practicing. Anytime you pick up a pencil and are doodling, you are in a sense practicing. And if you want to improve on your drawings, then, you know, like I said, pick a goal or pick one area of art that you want to improve on and consciously focus on improving that part. And that is practice and it's fun. I think more people want to be good at drawing than there are people that actually like to draw. And I think everybody kind of thinks this way, like violin. I wish I could just pick up a violin and fiddle and be really cool and be the belle of the ball and be that person who's at the campfire party and everybody's sitting around like, hey, let's sing songs. I'm like, I got you covered. And then I pull out the violin or a guitar or I build a drum set out of the nature around me and just rock out. I would love to be cool. That is my desire. I want to be good at just like creating music out of nothing. But you know, when I'm bored or when I'm like, I want to be creative, practicing music is not the first thing I go to. Same with gymnastics. I would love to be able to tumble. Anytime I see videos or GIFs of gymnasts doing those crazy floor routines, I would love to do that. That looks so cool and so fun. I don't want to wake up at 5 a.m. and practice tumbling. And I don't want to watch my figure and diet as much. And I don't want to exercise. So I guess I don't deserve to be an amazing gymnast or musician until I accept that I just need to work on it. So yes, Judah, if you want to draw, if you like drawing, if you like painting and making art, you're probably already practicing. So there. Next question is from Kevis, who says, love how smooth your image looks. What camera do you use? This camera that I use to make my time-lapse videos is the Sony Handycam CX160. I have had this for a long time, and I think it's a fairly affordable camcorder. If you're doing time-lapse videos, it's very handy to have a Handycam. It's good to have a camera that will, for me, I like to just turn it on and let it roll. And this camera just records until you make it stop or the card fills up. And there are many other cameras out there on the market, like DSLRs. The only thing about those is that they tend to overheat. And so they only have a shoot time of maybe 12 minutes on average, and then they turn off, which sometimes I've used my DSLR for the What Will I Draw videos to get these weird side angles that aren't always overhead, which is great. And I love the look of the DSLR, but you also have to be monitoring the camera and make sure that you are aware of when it's getting overheated and about to turn off. The cool thing about the Handycam too is that it's fairly lightweight, so it's easier to have it hover overhead. Right now my setup is the Handycam, and then there's a plastic handle that screws into the bottom of it where it would be mounted onto a tripod. The handle is, it's literally just a handle with a screw on the other end, and that fits perfectly into a microphone stand. And so for a while I was using a microphone stand with the boom, the arm that swings out. If you picture a musician playing guitar and then they're singing, it's that microphone that juts out in front of them. But now I have a Rode microphone arm mount. Are those the words I want to use? Sure. It's pretty much the mounted microphone stand that podcasters would use. And it's really nice. It just screws onto the table so you can move it around, and it can be temporary or it can be permanent, whatever. And it's adjustable so you can swing it out over the image. And yes, and as always, shooting in 1080p for high quality. And that's my camera equipment. A little bit about that. Here's a question from Ayana Suart, Ooh, and this is a heavier one. I hope I can do you justice and help you out, Ayana. Ayana says, I have a kind of hard question. I basically quit school this year, my junior year, because of stress and depression, and I want to know advice on how to move to Cali, California, and getting a job without going broke. I have skills in Photoshop, Illustrator, InDesign, Premiere Pro, and I paint and draw with many different mediums, but I have no experience and no money. This question may seem impossible, so I'll ask a simpler one just in case. How would I go about moving to California, especially LA, if I didn't have money to move but no job or place to live? All right. And then she says, I love your videos. I want to answer this very carefully, and my very first instinct is to say no, but then it might be one of those situations where you're writing in your amazing autobiography after an incredible life and career and saying, I was told no, which gave me fuel to tell myself yes, and I did it no matter what. I lived in a van, and I was broke for 5 years, and then I got my break. And after years of heartache, I succeeded. I don't know. Who knows how the story is going to end and where you go in between. But for safety's sake, I'm going to advise moving to California with nothing lined up, especially Los Angeles, is a terrible idea. It's not impossible, but it's a terrible idea. And you got to be prepared for the reality of that. When I came out here, I was with two friends that I knew, you know, and I had a job lined up. I had money saved up. We pooled together and got an apartment together, which is mandatory. If you get a place in Los Angeles, you kind of need roommates. It just goes without saying. So even with friends, even with money saved up, I still needed support from my parents and asked for help because with friends, a savings, a job, a place to live, it got bad. And Los Angeles, especially, is amazing for finding jobs and work in entertainment and the arts. But it kind of goes in waves. You know, you'll have, it's like the rains in California. You'll get these rainy seasons where the jobs are everywhere and you're so successful and wonderful. And then it dries up. And when it dries up, it gets very hard. And LA is not a cheap city. And rent is not cheap out here. So, if you have none of that lined up, you're probably going to be living in a car. And then, you know, the stereotype is that the car is going to break down and then you'll have those issues. I know people who have come out here with, you know, sensible backup plans and they've had to head home within months. And so you say you're a junior. I don't know if that's high school junior or college junior. I'm going to assume college. Because you have skills in all these areas. And that's awesome because in my experience, Photoshop, the most useful thing to know. I've been able to get weird freelance jobs and also help myself creating websites and business cards and whatnot with Photoshop. If you can do graphic design for yourself, that is a great skill to have because then you can do graphic design for other people and make money there. And with Premiere, knowing how to edit, there's plenty of freelance jobs and places you can find that online. I don't know like what the major websites are now. I mean, I took like Craigslist jobs when I was a kid, when I was first in college, and just did whatever jobs I could. So I don't know what kind of community you're living in now, but if you're anywhere where there might be businesses in need of graphic design or videos, or you can look online for freelance jobs requiring these skills. It's out there. It's available. And get some kind of resume and some kind of reel or portfolio built up before you really start looking into diving in. Because what can happen is if you just throw yourself out there You know, maybe it is that tactic of putting your back to the wall and, you know, it's win or die. And maybe that is what you need to push yourself forward. But I'm here in like going to LA with nothing lined up, no plans, no job experience. And then with like stress and depression being something very prominent and present in your life that has caused you to have to step back or pull back. It's disrupted plans in your life before. That just kind of sounds like a big recipe for disaster. And so maybe focus on where you're at now. And instead of putting yourself in a desperate situation that might put you in a even more dangerous situation, maybe take stock of what is working. What do you have now? Are you with your parents, or do you have a safe home and a environment that you can live in? Is there some stupid day job that you could get, you know, even if it is for just a few months to save up some money? Is there access to online resources to find freelance work? Is there local businesses? You know, is there, could you get a start getting creative with jobs? You could do graphic design for local businesses. You can find another author or like another creator out there and collaborate on a project. You could edit wedding videos, even, you know, just anything to build up that portfolio of your work. And it will get better if you, but I personally do not recommend drastic moves that might hurt you and become a mistake, because that might set you back. I think there's like this grass is greener fallacy, or like it's like the holy grail people sometimes have in mind, that I need to acquire this thing and then I will be better. Like, you know, for artists, it might be, once I get a digital drawing tablet, then my career will begin. Or once I move to California, then my career will begin. And it's not necessarily the case. I think that's just a fallacy. I think that's, you know, it's good to have these goals. But if you associate the success with this material place, whether it's a place or an object or a tool, if that's the requirement for your success, I think that can kind of set you up for disappointment. It's like that, there's that classic story of, was there a Simpson episode that used this with the tap shoes? Where it's like, well, I can't dance, but with these magic shoes, you can. And then like, you rock out, and then the character finds out at the end of the story, like, these shoes aren't magic. You had it in you this entire time. So moving to California is not a guarantee for success. But there's ways to find success all over the country, especially with the internet. And talking to Dante, who traveled, he just did the tour this last year, well, the last few years, and he traveled all over the U.S. And now, you know, in places like in Kansas and in Illinois and Indiana, Montana, all these places, like there's now hubs of beautiful creative people and art who are able to express themselves and work and make a living. And you don't have to be in a big major city just to succeed. That said, you know, you can always build yourself up where you're at now, do some freelance and start networking in your community or a closer area. And then once you've saved up and gotten to know yourself and gotten some confidence and built those muscles, then you can for sure move to a place that is like a little more challenging, like Los Angeles or New York. But those places are very expensive. And I do not recommend going down a black diamond if you're at a bunny hill level of skiing, if that makes sense. Now that I've crushed your dreams, I'm going to move on to the next question. And no, I hope I didn't crush your dreams. I hope that you take care of yourself and, you know, again, take stock of what is working. What do you have now, immediately right in front of you, as tools? You have these skills in these programs, and what else do you have? And what can you build on that before skipping town and throwing yourself down a dangerous path? Okay, Now I'm going to go on to Cassidy, who says, I love the art casts. Will we ever see a podcast with Dante? I want to address this question because I've actually been talking with Dante about podcasting and doing something together, mostly because we'll have, actually, we haven't been doing this lately, but we usually have breakfast sitting in our window and we just sit and judge our neighbors and talk about deep things in life. He is an amazing human being who is very attractive and has a brain and talent, and it's so incredible. And I want his thoughts out in the world because he's the intelligent one of the two of us. And so yeah, I've been kind of brainstorming putting together a podcast for a while. I think it's like a year ago I really started considering it, and then projects and life and everything gets in the way. So I'm actually working on setting that up. So if anybody has name suggestions, because that's really where I'm hung up, and the equipment. I think my goal is to start podcasting in April with Dante. This isn't a hard date that I'm putting on it, but I'm saying April is when I want it to happen. And I feel kind of weird saying that because I've definitely been overwhelmed with projects since the start of this year. Man, I hit the ground running and overpromised myself to too many people. And there's so many other goals that I want to get done and accomplish, like a webcomic, and there's a cartoon that I'm pitching, all sorts of things. And so it kind of sounds selfish to say, and I want a podcast, but I think it could be really cool. And I got some friends who are very talented, skilled artists with words of wisdom and experiences. I think for me, listening to podcasts while I paint, which is one of the many things. Sometimes I'll do music, sometimes I listen to podcasts. And I think the magic that those have, that these audio stories from real people has, is that you get a window into someone else's life. And the best part is when somebody divulges something very intimate and personal, and you're listening to it and you're thinking, me too. Oh my goodness, I'm not alone. Somebody else feels this way. That's amazing. And I feel like that kind of is it's a good thing. It's a healing thing. It's something the world could use. I think there's a lot of pain that has happened and come about because people just don't talk about things, and it creates a sense of isolation and loneliness. So, and also it's just really fun to get together with friends and talk about dumb stuff. So, yes, I am wanting to make that a thing in the near future. It's kind of tricky because we've both been so busy, me with whatever it is I do here, and Dante is working on the Epic Rap Battles of History, their newest season, and they're busy writing. He's an intricate part of their writing. He does the writing, but then he also does the like administrative stuff. I don't know, man. I don't do that job. I don't know the terminology. But he works with like the beat producers, the people who make the beats and licensing the music. And so he's on both sides of the stage. He's on stage and he's backstage. And when they're in writing mode and filming mode, it gets a little busy. But I'm kind of aiming for April because a part of, okay, if you really want to know, no, actually, I'm going to save that as a secret and wait for it to pan out and see if it works out. But I have an idea for the podcast and then where to take it. So that might be happening. I'm going to wrap up with a similar question from 20 Cents, not to be confused with 50 Cent, who says, hey, could you maybe put an audio-only version on iTunes or something like it? It makes downloading a podcast way easier. Thank you in advance. And 20 Cents, I am totally considering that. Going back to the idea of valuing your work from way at the beginning of this ArtCast, I did consider maybe when making these videos of making audio available to download. And me my own personal, like, the negative Nancy in my head said, don't do that, because this is a video regarding video, and I do reference what's happening on the screen, but not as much as I think. I tried to address it in the beginning and then just meander off and talk about other things. Anyway, I also did not think that the audio alone would hold up and be interesting enough, but apparently there's at least three people out there, 20 cents, and the two people who upvoted their comment who would disagree with me. So for future art casts, I think I'm going to look into setting up the iTunes. You know, while I'm looking at setting up a whole podcast, might as well make this just audio available as well. So look forward to that in the future. I'll keep you posted on it and let you know where it goes if it happens. It's another step. So, you know, I'm trying to streamline and make efficient my world and my realm. Maybe I need an assistant. Maybe it's time to hire help. Oh boy, I should call Morgan. Well, now I'm just scheduling and planning in my head out loud, which is tacky. But you know what? As I said, with podcasts and listening to what other people go through, it's a part of my experience as an artist, as a YouTuber, and a person who is making a living off of this internet thing and somehow not being busted on it, not being shipped back to a cubicle. Not that I've ever been in a cubicle. Anyway, the struggle's real, and these are the things I think about and are thinking about in my day-to-day life. Maybe I'll do a video on, like, what I do every day. That'll help me organize my thoughts and really sit down and say and look at myself honestly and go over what it is that I do. All right, enough of that rambling. I actually went through all of my questions that I pulled aside, which is impressive. High five to me. I'm applauding. If you have any questions or topics that you want to hear about in the next art cast, please leave a comment below. I can't get to all of them, but I will do my best, and I'll try to pull things that will help and give answers that will help, or at least not drive you off a cliff with bad advice. And if you're an artist, or if you have an experience and you see comments below that you have answers to or suggestions, like, please feel free to jump in and help, because all of the advice or the tips that you're hearing in this video, this is my personal opinion based on my own personal experiences. And, you know, I might be biased in a way, and maybe you know, somebody out there has some really great advice and tips and suggestions for those who need them. Anyway, next Thursday, I think I'm going to do another art cast. And if there's a particular video you want to see the real-time version of, also let me know. I don't know which art cast I want to do, but I definitely want to do it for next Thursday. And in April, I'm going to be going on a video hiatus, meaning that you're still going to get every Monday videos. I shot a bunch of Zen doodles for April. So Mondays in April, it's going to be all Zen doodles. And that way I will have all my videos done well ahead of time, and I will have an entire month to sit down and do more large scale projects to get ahead of schedule and hopefully not be stressed and trying to catch up. And I will be shooting tutorials and how to art. So that's going to be coming back, but it won't be until May. I'll be writing those all of April, which is very exciting. And then hopefully I'll be podcasting. Do you now see how it is that I get overwhelmed with too much work? I'm like, yeah, no, I can do this project and this project and this project. So April hiatus, which again, video's still coming out, but I'm just not going to be doing current videos so that I can get ahead of schedule. And that's the end of that story. Until then, though, I'm going to do another art cast. So let me know what do you want to see a real-time video of, and if you have any questions. And that is the end of that. Thank you, dear Doodlebugs, for sitting through this and watching and listening to me rant and ramble at the very end of this video, just touching up the video as I'm touching up the painting. Going back to the painting, let's talk about that. Because I tend to, I sign my paintings at the very end, and that's that. And as you can see, I signed the painting and then decided that I kind of wanted to touch up the squid and add a little more texture and shadow and detail, which is fine, which is fair enough. But I don't have the comment or the question in front of me, but I do know somebody asked about what to do about not finishing your paintings or like constantly going at a painting that's already done, but like continuously tweaking it. And one tip for that is just make the rule. Once you sign it, it's done. No touchy after it's signed. And if that is a rule, I'm totally breaking it right here, but that's what art is all about. You know, there's rules and then there's broken rules, and every rule is breakable when you make paintings. All right. The end. Thank you, Doodlebugs. And until next time, bye-bye.